They are working on that.
So, gentlemen, we are very happy to have Professor Haris Kosmas from the University of Ioannina telling us how to calculate neutrino nucleus cross sections for neutrinos of interesting sources. Please.
First of all, I would like to thank Professor Barrett and his collaborators for inviting me here for a few days to discuss our common research interests. And I'm happy to present the nuclear physics aspects we do in my university. Specifically today, the title is referred to the cross-sections of neutrino nucleus reactions in energies up to 120 MeV, which overlap with the energy range of currently interesting neutrino sources. My collaborators from Ioannina, the two PhD students and other professors from the two Greek institutes, we cooperate also with the Darmstadt group of Professor Obama. From TBGM Steel, specifically Kokotas, who is dealing with gravitational waves, is supporting us from astrophysics research. With Suhonen from Finland, we do about the same calculations, but the models are a bit different. The particle physics is supported by your institute here, because all these processes are coexistence of nuclear particle physics and also astrophysics. Experimental support is done from the group of Aegean. In the introduction, I'll first go through a brief review on the intermediate sources of our interest. Then I'll describe in brief how we study from the nuclear physics point of view the coherent and incoherent cross sections for neutral current and charged current reactions. The nuclear method we are using is the quasi-particle RPA, a refinement version of this. We have constructed recently an advantageous code which gives us all nuclear matrix elements needed not only for neutrino processes but also for other charged current processes, as you will see here in electron capture. And the results are, I mostly focus on the incoherent cross sections, since the coherent cross sections have been discussed by Dimitris Papoulas a few days ago. Then I summarize the main conclusions extracted from these studies. Very well known intermediate energy neutrino sources, the laboratory neutrinos coming out of stopped pion and muon decays with energies up to 60 MeV, the reactor neutrinos up to 10 MeV, the spallation neutron source which have the same energy range with the stopped pion muon stopped neutrinos, and also astrophysical neutrino sources, the well-known surround neutrinos up to 18 MeV, the supernova neutrinos, and recently the geoneutrinos with energies up to 8 to 10 MeV. Here something is missing. The pion muon stopped decay neutrinos are produced through all these are produced through these reactions. Unfortunately, I don't know why the well-known figure is not the expressions are not seen. Have you met this problem in meters? No. Okay. Of course, these are appropriate to parameterize the supernova neutrinos, and except at the borders in the high energy tail, where both these neutrino are open or very close, they go to zero soon.
Reactor neutrino,
the recent experiments mostly plan to study the coherent process of these electron and the neutrinos. The detector is either germanium-76 or maybe some other. Recently, the neutrinos came to the game because they can be used to constrain various Earth models. They come out of such beta decay reactions. Q is the Q value of the process. And here there are two series, the uranium series, with about 80 decay isotopes, and the thorium series about 70, and also the gallium 40. You see here the energy distribution of them. This is from uranium, this is from thorium, and the other is from gallium. Very low, in the, up to 1 mV, 2 dB, or 3 mV, respectively. The well-known solar neutrinos, all of us will know that they played a decisive role to solve the solar neutrino puzzle and also to understand the neutrino oscillations. In our case, these two, the boronate neutrinos and the head neutrinos, are in the region of interest. This is well-known supernova neutrinos. Mostly come out of these two processes. Specifically, we are interested about the electron capture here, which plays a key role in the pre-supernova and the during supernova or collapse. Other reactions, they also play a good role in the formation of the beam which comes out. In general, in our calculations, we assume that a monochromatic beam enters to the detector, and our calculations start based on this hypothesis. However, most of neutrino beams are distributions, and the distribution means the, this differentiation. So we wish to have this spectral distribution of each neutrino source. After that, we put in our original calculations and produce the response of the nuclear detector to that specific neutrino distribution, neutrino source. This is a good tool for experimentalists. You remember here the three neutrinos, neutrino beams, electron neutrinos, electron neutrinos, and NX with the energies 10 to 12, mean energies 15 to 16, and about 20 to 25. So we are using various parameterizations for the supernova neutrinos. It's one of the most interesting distribution for us. There are in the market two distributions used, the Fermi-Dirac and the Power Law. Both of them are parameterized, the first two by the neutrino temperature and the degeneracy parameter, the other, the second, the mean neutrino energy and the pinching parameter. You see here for the various, there is a correspondence between these two and the parameters are shown here. The conclusion is that both of them are appropriate, and there is a, and they give approximately similar results. In a list of processes here, the two categories of neutrino nucleus processes, the charged current in which the signal is the outgoing lepton in the neutral current, where the signal is the nuclear recoil of gamma ray is expected, or gamma ray, unless there are in both cases large energies when proton or neutrons are released. But then one should have a statistical model to conduct the calculations and insert the branching ratio of each of these channels. We don't do such types of calculations. Here are, as I said, the charged current processes by the electron capture, beta plus minus decays, or the particle conjugate reactions of them, which are interested in the supernova, in the description of corporate supernova, in the pre-supernova, and the supernova phase. Using the same nuclear model, we study also lepton flavor non-conservation processes discussed by Dimitrios Papoulias, and this is what we do for decades, specifically in the exotic processes, the muon to electron conversion, and the exotic neutrino nucleus processes, where non-standard neutrino interactions have been inserted recently in the description. In our calculations, we start by assuming that the operator, the weak interaction Hamiltonian, starts from the quark level, it goes to the nuclear level, and finally to the nuclear level where the calculations are done. So we start by Feynman diagrams like this for standard model, and the other with the non-standard model Feynman diagrams, and then we write the Hamiltonian as a product of lepton current times a hadronic current. Our task is to calculate nuclear matrix elements of these four here, where I is the initial state of the nucleus, F is the final state. This is with the leptonic matrix element, and here Q is the momentum transfer, which depending on the process is related to the energies of the initial and final nucleus. So, as I said before, our task is to calculate these matrix elements entering here, the Coulomb longitudinal, transverse electric, and transverse magnetic. And in the case of the incoherent neutrino nucleus cross-sections, we start from the double differential cross-section with respect to the angles here, and omega is the excitation energy of the nucleus. This is not a flavor blind process. There is a plus minus sign. The plus is for anti-neutrino, and the minus is for the neutrino case. And this term is a well-known parity violation term. This is the vector, axial vector part, because in our calculations, as we will see here, we distinguish the contribution of the vector, axial vector, and this is the overlap term.
Which process you are considering now, specifically?
Now is the original neutrino nucleus cross-sections.
Okay,
but in all cases, we do about the same thing. The matrix elements are of this type, and the only difference is here in these factors, which are, include the nucleon form factors. So this is the only change which is inserted in the inserts a difference between the various calculations. As I said, we try to help experimentalists as much as possible with our calculations. This means starting from our original cross-sections, we try to simulate the signal or the response which is expected to be recorded in the detector of the experimentalist, of the various experiments. The isotopes we started are the deuterium, cadmium and the zinc, which are media materials of these two detectors used in the copper experiment and which is used in the quarry experiment. Quarry experiment has the largest mass as a detector today.
But this is for double beta decay.
This is, yes, for double beta decay, but this is multi-purpose experiments. This means they put, they have in their mind to use the detector to detect neutrinos and also dark matter. Dark matter, of course, I should stress that dark matter and the coherent neutrino nucleus channel could be studied simultaneously. Or not all detectors, you are very right, not all detectors could be use the same signal.
Mm-hmm. What is the status of cobra, Magali?
The status of cobra, I met last week in Osaka. They don't have approval yet to proceed further, but they are optimistic. In the meantime, he is working in the snow plus experiment, so they do the same to work with other experiments. Here you see how the original total cross-sections look like in the case, as an example, zinc 64. This is here, the dust is the contribution of the axial vector part of the operator, component of the operator. This is the vector, and this is the overlap term. One sees that the overlap term, even though for low energies, is not very important, it becomes important in energies about 60-70 MeV, and it may be more important than even the vector component. Here also original calculations for the cumulative cross-section, it shows how the cross-section piles up as the excitation energy of the nucleus is increased. And one can see from the big steps here that there is some resonance in that energy. For example, here you see that it corresponds to 16 MeV. It's the giant dipole resonance. And the total for this initial neutrino energy could be used, as you will see below, to obtain the fluxes for this specific neutrino detector, tellurium 28 or tellurium 130. Both of them exist in the core detector. The connection to these experiments could be done by folding the original cross-sections using the neutrino energy distribution of the specific neutrino source, and the folding is doing in this way here. This is the signal we expect to be recorded in the detector. These are the original calculations we do, and this is a parameterization of the specific neutrino source. Also, other cases of signals could be simulated, like the total or the double differential cross-section here.
Just a stupid question. I mean, in the folding, you need to multiply the flux times the cross-section.
Yes. The flux, you mean the
distribution. Flux of the source, yeah, the distribution.
Yeah, the distribution.
That's what you call it.
Okay, this is done. This is done here. Uh-huh. Here is the signal expected to be recorded. Here is the theoretical calculation, and this is the distribution for the total cross-section. But here is for the differential cross-section, and similarly for the double differential, etc. Of course, other less interesting quantity is this number, the flux average cross-section. This is a number only. Since this is a moment of the distribution, it tells something. If you don't have other information, it's also useful information. For example, with Eulogio in 93, we have done only such types of calculations and are still interesting. Mm-hmm. It's not easy to do these calculations because one needs to have the original cross-section as a function of the excitation energy of the detector. And also the energy of the neutrino energy. Here you see the double differential cross-section, the folding. And of course one can discuss various conclusions. For example, the high energy tails play a significant role in the response of the detector. This also is a response of the detector, but up to now there are no such measurements. The only measurement concerning double differential cross-section has been done 2 years ago to 3 years ago at Fermilab. So, but these are what we expect to see in the future. Let us stay here,
This is the Minerva people?
Not the mini boom people. Mini boom. Or boom in general. Micro boom. Here you see the folded single differential cross section we obtained by using in the first mean energy of the supernova neutrino Tenebri. This means the first is the response of the detector in the electron neutrino case of the supernova, the electron neutrino component. Here is the electron antineutrino component and the response to the detector if this detector is tellurium 128 or 130, one of these two. The responses are 22, okay, 128 tellurium. This is a different response, and the last one corresponds to the new X neutrinos. This means lots of excitations are present here. And the experimentalists should focus on one of these excitations, if they could distinguish in the supernova case. So the other connection with experiments could be done by using the theoretical cross-sections, the total number of the nuclei of the isotopes in the detector, and if assuming an event rate good for the experiment, for experimentalists, we could obtain the flux, which should come from to the detector and have a rather a positive measurement. For example, for the core experiment, assuming that the responses of tellurium and 128 and 130 are approximately the same, there is this number of nuclei in the 988 crystal barometers of tellurium oxide. This means a mass of tellurium about 400 kilograms. So we find, using our calculations, that the flux should be of this order, but this is a good flux of the order of recent experimental sources. So if tellurium of this order would be used to measure cross-sections,
when you get such numbers in the flux, you never get that energy.
The energy for energy of the neutrinos.
Yes, yes.
This is for supernova neutrinos.
But supernova never occur at 50 MeV.
Of course, yes.
Lower energies.
A bit lower, I think.
No, 20 MeV is UX.
UX are above 60.
I guess it depends on the model. On the astrophysics model. But my impression also is that it's somewhat lower.
Here is the mean energies here.
Mean energy is very low, yeah, but you have a tail of high energy neutrinos.
And maybe in this tail recently has been improved, and it goes very slowly to zero. It's still, if you add other effects.
So, in other words, you are saying even though there are much fewer neutrinos, their higher energy somehow compensates.
Yes.
In the detection.
Yes, this is.
You cannot neglect the detection.
Not.
Well, but it's true that the mean energy is, like Martin says,
the cross section grows very fast. With
tense.
Energy.
Yeah.
Yes. But can you go back to that slide, please?
But the flux also go.
Yes, let me show also.
If you go back to that slide.
Let me also show. Not here we have. This is also possible. You could have 50 MeV in that experimental.
Yeah, you go to a spallation source and then you get.
Yes, yes. You could use the tellurium there.
Yeah.
And obtain the flux is even more.
However, then you have to move that detector to this source.
You are,
and they will never move it to this source.
You are fully right,
yeah.
Because this is immovable, or this detector is.
Yeah, but mentally you get all the exercise, and maybe one day, then you will be able to set it up.
Just comment on experimental possibilities.
At the moment.
Of course, experimentalists do a very good job, not only theorists. do it. This is another example. In the for 30 MeV neutrinos, the flux is of the same order. 30 MeV is close to the mean energy of NX, 26. Some models they put 28. In the okay, in the charge changing processes here, these are the electron capture, original electron capture cross-section. In the case of iron 56, this has been done by the other PhD student, the lady Panayota Yanaka. Of course, the folding procedure is a bit different in this case, because here it says laboratory conditions. This means all previous calculations have been done in laboratory conditions. But here we have to translate these cross-sections in the stellar environment, because the target is in the interior of a supernova, and the translation is done through such an expression, which means we take into account the temperature dependence of the cross-section. We enter the temperature dependence through the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, not only because the electrons are in this environment, but also because the target is in the same environment. This means that in the laboratory, all nuclear targets are in the ground state. But this is not the case in the external environment, where one should have about 3-4 at least initial states, up to 3 or 4 MeV. This is the solar translation.
Electron capture now, the signal is the recoil?
For the electron capture, the signal is the excitation of the nucleus. But the neutrino...
And where do we have the electron? Sorry, I'm ignorant.
The electron...
The electron, where it comes from?
Sure. First... The electron in the laboratory could be, for example, the orbital electron.
Okay.
But then the energy is small, up to some few MeV. It could be a beam of electrons having a bit larger energy.
Stellar electron capture.
But this is in stellar environment, means within the interior of a supernova, pre-supernova or after supernova explosion, then the energies, of course, are of this order. And the importance of this process is that they contribute the maximum in the formation of the neutrino beam coming out of the supernova.
So in some sense, they determine the flux of the neutrino.
They determine the flux of the neutrino, so I showed before, they come to the terrestrial detector. And here, this is the difference from the...
Nuclear astrophysics.
Nuclear astrophysics is. How much time do I have?
15-20
minutes. Okay. In the case of the neutrino nucleus interaction, the neutral current channel, the coherent channel is possible, and this is the most dominant channel. This means that most important than all other incoherent channels. But from an experimental point of view, one needs to use a different detector because the signal is different. Here, for the coherent channel to be observed, one has as a signal the recoil of the target of the detector or the gamma ray emission, but like in the case of dark matter. Most of the experiments at the beginning started to use this signal, the nuclear recoil, and the differential cross-section in this case could be written not as a function of the angles here, as it is shown here, but in similar expression with respect to the recoil energy. I hope that Dimitris has discussed this other type of differential cross-section. From a nuclear physics point of view, the task is rather easier because here we have to calculate this from nuclear form factors rather exactly and put it here where all other parameters are known. However, since up to now no experiment, no event has been measured, even for the coherent channel, the experiments only recently are ready to try for such measurements. There is the coherent in the spallation source at Oak Ridge and other experiments. So we could offer, using our calculations, the cross-sections, the faulted cross-sections, or the event rates and the number of events expected to be measured for various detectors. And this we do for various detectors. Of course, even for the COBRA detector, the referee asked to do these calculations, irrespectively if COBRA could be used for measurements using the recoil, the nuclear recoil as a signal. And one of my co-operators done it, and of course it is published, this. Here you see the flux Ernst cross-section by using the geoneutrinos. Not many calculations exist for geoneutrinos.
Actually, I have a question there.
Yeah.
Because normally for supernova neutrinos, Super K has a higher threshold and they want really to get rid of this background coming from this. I guess partly that they cannot go to such low energies, and also partly that not much is known about the cross-sections. So if you want, understand, you want to avoid,
yes,
because you don't know. But if you know, maybe you can actually study.
Completely.
No, Super K, I think they have a problem to go to low energies.
Kamlan was the
they want to get rid of it.
No, I understand.
Sorry, that's what I wanted.
But I understand that in principle they can go lower, but they avoid it because they don't
flashes.
Know.
You need to know the flashes to do the fit, the combined fit of geoneutrinos in reality. If you don't know exactly, then you just put a cut.
Yeah. As I showed, the geoneutrino distribution is very low, and the maximum in the first case, in the one case, is only 1 MeV, 2 MeV, and 3 MeV, as you could see here. So these are the distributions. This means from a theoretical point of view, we should have a reliable model to calculate the excitations up to 1 MeV, in the case of calcium, potassium body, up to 2 MeV in the case of thorium, and up to 3 MeV in the case of uranium. So small, the excitation could be done up to this energy. But for low energies, the excitations are more reliable in most of the models. If this model could, has the possibility to calculate. For example, if only Fermi and Gamow Teller operators are put in the calculations, one is then neglecting the momentum dependence of the operators, Q equals to zero, we have only the Fermi and Gamow Teller, then the Gamow Teller means excitation above approximately 10 MeV, reliable case. These were the first, the calculations mostly up to now in the case of electron capture, I showed before.
So to study these guys, what I said, I guess, is not correct. You need not only to have a good calculation of the cross section for
you the
interaction with some target, but you also need to know the flux. And the
yes.
flux you cannot control.
Yes.
The flux is an empirical thing with big errors, I guess.
And also, you must choose the detector appropriately so that the energy threshold is very low. This means that's why the observation of geoneutrinos is not optimistic for the next decade, one, 2 years. But since we are asked to do such calculations, we are willing to do, or students must be willing to do. And the young researchers.
If they are not willing.
Yes.
Yes.
So, the other case, the reactor neutrino case, is also difficult, but there the beam is very intense. So, this is more optimistic. Solar neutrinos, of course, just for completeness.